Welcome to the first lecture of digital communication. In this lecture, we'll be learning introduction to digital communication system as a basic building block, advantages and disadvantages of digital transmission over analog transmission, pulse code modulation technique, its encoder and decoder with three different steps such as sampling, quantization and binary encoding. To start with, this is a block diagram of digital communication system. I'll be explaining each of these blocks in detail. We have source, source encoder, channel encoder, modulator, transmitter, and finally the generated signal is transmitted over the channel. And at the receiver side, it will be received by receiving antenna and passed through detector or modulator, then channel decoder, then source decoder, and then at the end we have the output, which is same as the transmitted generated signal at source. You see that at receiver we have exactly same block but in reverse order. So first, source encoder, it can be analog or digital in nature. If it is analog, the generated data will be converted to digital domain and then it is passed on to the next block. The source encoder, it is important in order to strengthen the source. Why? Because it reduces the redundant bits present in the generated information and it makes a system bandwidth efficient. And this is necessary because generally digital communication needs larger bandwidth than the analog communication. To understand, I have this. We have a low pass analog signal of 4 kHz. If we send it as it is using analog communication, the minimum required bandwidth will be equal to 4 kHz. And in a digital domain, we have to first sample it, quantize it, and assign 8 bits to each sample. So that makes 64 kbps as a bit rate. And generally, the bandwidth is half of a bit rate, which is equal to required bandwidth equal to 32 kHz. And we'll understand this in detail later, but you can simply compare these two numbers. The analog bandwidth is 4 kHz with the digital required bandwidth is equal to 32 kHz. The next block is channel encoder. Channel encoder adds on some extra bits to the output of a source encoder, and these bits are called as redundant bits. These are necessary in error detection and error correction purpose. Every time correction of all the errors is not possible, but at least it can correct few of them. The modulator converts that bit stream into equivalent electrical waveform by minimizing the noise effects. We already know the function of modulator in analog communication. It reduces the antenna height. It makes multiplexing possible. In analog domain, we also know that because of use of modulator, bandwidth was reduced. So here also we will be using modulator. And at the end, we have a transmitting antenna block. Here, additional amplification, filtering and coupling will be done, and the transmitter processes that final input to produce the signal that is best suited for the communication channel, and it is transmitted over that channel. At receiver side, exactly reverse procedure will be done and the receive signal will be received back in original form. Now we'll talk about some advantages of digital transmission very fast. First is a noise immunity is improved. As we all know, in analog communication, the noise gets added and hence the signal looks like this, as I have shown here, a sine wave with noise becomes distorted. And in digital domain, we can have something called as a thresholding and regeneration. Because of that, when digital signal received is above threshold, it is detected as an output 1. When it is below threshold, it will be detected as output 0. And hence, the regeneration produces the waveform something like this, which has almost negligible effect of the noise which is present. Second advantage is Multiplexing becomes easy. So digital signals are better suited than analog signals for multiplexing, and hence multiplexing devices are also available in digital domain. Next is easy to store compared to analog domain. It is resistant to additive noise, as we have already learned, and hence regeneration is possible instead of amplification. Hence, long distance transmission is also possible. You can see here the analog sine waveform after amplification through noise. It looks like this. And even if noise is present in digital domain, the regeneration gives us a fresh waveform, which is same as the original one. Transmission errors can be easily detected, as we have channel coding techniques, error control and error detection techniques available here. It is cheaper because it is possible to manufacture very high speed embedded circuits due to the advancements in VLSI technology in a cost effective manner. Availability of good tested techniques makes it superior than the analog transmission. We have a good privacy because some encryption techniques can be used, which makes our system more secure. So transmitter and receiver will only know what is being transmitted. No one else can know. It is very flexible, as we all know, and there is a scope for development because of this flexibility. In the disadvantages, majorly we talk about bandwidth requirement. As I already said, digital transmission needs larger bandwidth than the analog transmission, and hence the cost also will be more. Extra circuitry for encoding and decoding is required, as we have a channel encoder and channel decoder for error detection and correction capability. And it requires synchronization at transmitter and receiver clock. If that synchronization gets lost, everything gets lost. High power consumption is one of the other disadvantage in digital transmission. We'll learn something called as a pulse code modulation as a next topic. In a pulse code modulation, we'll be discussing three steps called as sampling, quantization, and binary encoding. The first step, sampling itself, means that get a sample from the original signal. If original signal is continuous in amplitude, it will have infinite amplitude levels. We will get only amplitudes at certain intervals of time, and those amplitudes are called as samples. So we obtain samples after every TS second. This T subscript S is called as a sampling interval. And the inverse of that is called as a sampling rate or sampling frequency. There are three different sampling methods available. First is ideal sampling, where an impulse will be used for instant sampling. Second, natural, where a short width pulse will be used, whose amplitude will be dependent on amplitude of an analog signal which is being sampled. And third, the flat top sampling, where again a short width pulse will be used, but its amplitude is not exactly varying with the analog signal, but it is flat, but still it is dependent on an analog signal. How? That we will see in next slide. So these three techniques are generally called as pulse amplitude modulation, and the outcome is a signal with analog non-integer values. Here we can see that the analog signal, dotted black signal, is sampled, the pink samples sampled, and we have amplitudes at discrete intervals of time only. The spacing between two consecutive samples is equal to sampling period, TS. This is ideal sampling example. This is natural sampling example, where this is a pulse, this is a short width pulse, this is also a short width pulse, this is also a short width pulse. These are pulses whose amplitudes are varying according to the input analog signal. This is a natural sampling, and this is flat top sampling. As I said, the amplitude will not be varying with respect to the input signal, but it is flat, but still it is dependent on input. Why? Because the initial edge will have amplitude same as the analog input signal, and that same amplitude level is continued till the pulse duration, complete pulse duration. According to the Nyquist theorem, the sampling rate must be at least twice than that of the maximum frequency component present in the analog signal. So if our analog signal which is to be sampled has very high frequency component, then its sampling rate will be double than that very high frequency. So to avoid high sampling rates, very high sampling rates, generally it is useful to low pass filter the original signal before we sample it. Though we filter, it is very necessary to take care that we do not distort the signal. That is, we do not remove the high frequency components which will affect the signal shape. Here is the example of Nyquist sampling rate for low pass and band pass signals. As a low pass signal has a maximum frequency component fmax here, the Nyquist rate is equal to 2 times of fmax. This is minimum sampling rate required to sample this signal, 2 times of fmax. Bandpass signal has minimum frequency fmin and maximum frequency fmax. If we want to sample this signal, then Nyquist rate, the minimum sampling rate, should be equal to 2 times of fmax. So we note that Nyquist rate is totally dependent on the maximum frequency component present in a signal, and it is independent on a bandwidth of a signal. Here f minimum is equal to 0, here f minimum is equal to some non-zero frequency, but still Nyquist rate is 2 times of fmax. As an example, we will sample a sine wave with 3 different sampling rates. First with 4f, which is 2 times of the Nyquist rate. Second with 2f, which is same as the Nyquist rate, and third f, which is 1/2 of the Nyquist rate, where f is a maximum frequency component present in that sinusoid which is to be sampled. We see that if I sample with sampling rate fs is equal to f, which is half of the Nyquist rate, then the samples which are generated, if these samples are given to someone and asked to reconstruct the original signal from which these samples are derived, then logically what one can do is, one will try to connect these samples to prepare a graph. That would be the probable approximation of analog signal from which these samples are derived. But if we compare this and this, this is nowhere closer to the original sine wave, and hence sampling rate f, which is half than the Nyquist rate, is not suitable. If we use sampling rate fs is equal to 2f, which is Nyquist rate, then we see that the generated samples, if connected in a sequence, will get some graph which is similar to a triangular wave, which is somewhat closer to sinusoid compared to this one, but not exactly. Instead, if we add few more samples in between, for that I should have sampling frequency larger than 2f. If I add few more samples here, 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 and here, that will smooth out our graph, and that will become more better approximation for this sinusoid. So sampling rate greater than 2f is desired, but sampling rate equal to 2f can marginally do our task. This is another example where fs is equal to 4f, which is much higher than the required rate. But still, you see that the generated samples, intermediate samples, cannot give any additional information. As you can see, this and this graph are almost same. So fs is equal to 4f is a case called as oversampling, which is not so useful. I can conclude like this, that it can be seen that sampling at a Nyquist rate can create good approximation of the original sine wave. Oversampling can create same approximation, but it is redundant and unnecessary. And sampling below the Nyquist rate does not produce a signal that looks like an original sine wave. Let's take an example. A telephone company digitizes human voice by assuming the maximum frequency equal to 4 kHz. What would be the sampling rate in that case? Your guess is right. As maximum frequency component is 4 kHz, we will have 2 times of 4 kHz, that is 8000 Hz as a sampling rate. Next, a complex low pass signal has a bandwidth of 200 kHz. What is the minimum sampling rate required for this signal? As we have already discussed, in a low pass signal, maximum frequency component is same as a bandwidth, that is equal to 200 kHz. So sampling rate will be 2 times of this, that is 400 kHz. If we consider an example of a band pass signal with bandwidth of 200 kHz, then what will happen to the sampling rate? In this case, we only know the bandwidth of a band pass filter, but where that band is placed is not known to us. So maximum frequency component is not known to us. So in this case, we cannot comment on the required sampling rate. After sampling, the second step is quantization for pulse code modulation. Sampling results in a series of pulses of varying amplitudes, which ranges from minimum to maximum value. The amplitude values are infinite in between that minimum and maximum. What we can do is, we can map those infinite amplitude values onto a finite set of known values. This is achieved by dividing the distance between minimum to maximum into L equidistant zones with each zone of height delta. So as you can see here, L is equal to 8. So we have 8 zones, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th, and each of height delta, where this amplitude is minimum and this amplitude is maximum. What will be delta in this case? Delta is equal to maximum minus minimum divided by number of zones L. The midpoint of each zone is assigned a value from 0 to L minus 1, resulting in L values. So consider we have 4 zones, then we'll assign midpoint of each zone a value 0, 1, 2 and 3, where 3 is nothing but L minus 1, L is equal to 4. Each sample falling in that particular zone is approximated to the value of that midpoint. Assume we have a voltage signal with amplitudes minus 20 volt minimum to plus 20 volt maximum. If we want L equal to 8 quantization levels, then each zone will be of width 20 minus minus 20 by 8 is equal to 5 volt. We can have zones like this: minimum minus 20, 5 volts of minus 15, 5 volts of minus 10, 5 volts of minus 5 and so on. So we have total 8 zones, and these will be the midpoints of those zones. Minus 20 to minus 15, midpoint is this, minus 17.5. minus 15 to minus 10, midpoint is minus 12.5 and so on. Now each zone is assigned a binary code. The number of bits required to assign that binary code will be dependent on number of quantization levels. So if we have L quantization levels, then number of bits necessary will be log to the base 2 of L, where we have, in previous example, we have 8 quantization levels, so the necessary number of bits for each sample is equal to 3. Then 8 zones or 8 levels can be assigned with binary codes 000 to 111. 000 will be the lowest one, that is minus 20 to minus 15. 001 will be the second zone, that is minus 15 to minus 10, and so on. To understand, you can have a look at this example. We have a sinusoid with maximum plus 20 volt to minimum minus 20 volt. It is sampled and the sample values are represented on top of each sample. Now we want to pulse code modulate this, so we have assigned zones. L is equal to 8 zones. So first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth. Assume that this D is equal to 5. So 0 to minus 5, minus 5 to minus 10, minus 10 to minus 15, minus 15 to minus 20. Now on this side, 5, 10, 15, and 20. We have assigned midpoint of each of them a value from 0 to L minus 1. So midpoint here is assigned value 0, here 1, here 2, here 3, and up to L minus 1, that is 7. Now we can see that this amplitude is minus 6.1. If I normalize it, what I said? Normalization means 5 volt is equal to 1D. So this is actually minus 1.22 volt, minus 6.1 divided by 5. So these are actual values. These are normalized quantized values, means what? Each amplitude falling in this particular zone will be assigned to its midpoint value, and midpoint here is minus 1d to minus 2d. Midpoint is minus 1.5d, so this will be minus 1.5. this also will be minus 1.5. this will be minus 1.5. this also will be minus 1.5. here this is d to 2d, so this will be 1.5d plus 1.5d. this will be plus 2.5. this will be plus 3.5. so it's like this. Check the amplitude, see what is quantization code for it, and assign equivalent binary to it. Again, for this sample, like this. So these are actual values normalized. These are corresponding zone centers normalized. And finally, we have binary codes here. Bitrate and bandwidth requirement of PCM can be explained with the help of sampling frequency FS and number of bits required in each sample. So if we have FS, number of samples per second, and NB, number of bits per each sample, then bitrate will be NB into FS, number of bits per second. To understand, again take an example of human voice. Maximum frequency is 4 kilohertz and sampling rate will be 2 times of 4 kilohertz, that is 8 kilohertz, that is 8000 samples per second, and hence bitrate will be 8000 into 8 bits per sample. So it is specified that, assume that 8 bits per sample are used, hence we have 64 kbps. Finally, the PCM encoder will look like this. The analog signal applied to the sampler, sampling output, it may be ideal, natural, or flat top. It is applied to the quantizer. Quantizer will produce fixed number of amplitude levels by using quantization. And at the end of encoding, we will see a binary digital data output. PCM decoder performs exactly opposite task. It receives a digital signal and generates an analog signal. It uses a hold circuit that holds the amplitude value of a pulse till the next pulse arrives, and it will connect all such amplitudes and form a signal which will be then passed through a low pass filter. The cutoff frequency of that low pass filter will be equal to highest frequency in the pre-sampled signal, and at the end we get a analog signal as output. If number of quantization levels used in quantizer are much large, then less distorted will be the signal which is recovered. This is how PCM decoder looks like. Input digital data, make and connect samples using hold circuit. So these are the amplitudes which are hold for next pulse duration, and then pass through a low pass filter, it will give you the analog signal. The complete PCM system looks like this: sampler, quantizer, encoder, through channel, and at receiver again a decoder and reconstruction filter. That's all for today. Thank you.